Αγαπητέ Κάρεν, είμαστε εδώ στο έκτο συνέδριο του Marefor, το έκτο συνέδριο Blue Summit Shipping. Βεβαίως καταλαβαίνουμε και από τον τίτλο ότι είναι για το περιβάλλον, το θαλάσσιο περιβάλλον, την προστασία του και τους νέους κανονισμούς γενικότερα. Αλλά μίλησε μας λίγο για αυτό το συνέδριο, που δίνεται περισσότερο έμφαση και γενικά γιατί επικεντρωθήκατε σε αυτό το τομέα των περιβαλλοντολογικών θεμάτων για την ναυτιλία.
Κοιτάξτε να δείτε, φίλε μου Μάρκο, χωρίς το περιβάλλον δεν μπορούμε να ζήσουμε. Οπότε χωρίς το περιβάλλον δεν υπάρχει ουσία και πρέπει να το προσέχουμε για να φροντίζουμε για τις επόμενες γενιές. Δεν είναι το τι γίνεται σήμερα, αλλά η πραγματικότητα είναι το αύριο που θα ζήσουμε. Το αύριο θα ζουν τα παιδιά μας. Οπότε άμα δεν κάνουμε ό,τι περνάει από τα χέρια μας ώστε να μπορέσουμε να το διασώσουμε, το οποίο έτσι είναι και ο τίτλος του event μας, λέγεται «Διασώζοντας το περιβάλλον». Γι' αυτό έχουμε επιλέξει να επικεντρωθούμε πάνω σε αυτό φέτος. Ήταν η πρώτη φορά που το κάναμε έτσι, γιατί πιστεύουμε ότι έχει έρθει η ώρα να φέρουμε όλα τα φώτα της δημοσιότητας και της ναυτιλίας στο προσκήνιο. Και έχουμε φέρει πάρα πολλούς ανθρώπους από την ευρωπαϊκή κοινότητα, πλειοκτήτες από τις διοργανώσεις, την ΕΛΜΕΠΑ, τη ΑΙΜΕΠΑ, την ΙΝΤΕΡΜΕΠΑ και όλες τις άλλες classification societies σαν την Lloyd's Register και την ABS και την ΡΗΝΑ, οι οποίοι όλοι μαζί προσπαθούν να κάνουμε ό,τι καλύτερο μπορούμε για το περιβάλλον μας.
Βλέπεις ότι η συμμετοχή από αυτούς τους φορείς και κυρίως πέραν τους ναυτιλιακούς που είναι οι νεογνώμονες, τα κλασιφικές τους δηλαδή, αλλά και από πλευράς θεσμικών φορέων, βλέπετε από την προσυνεννόησή σας να έχουν το ενδιαφέρον να μιλήσουν, να έρθουν στο συνέδριό σας εδώ στην Ελλάδα και να μιλήσουν μπροστά στην μεγαλύτερη ναυτιλία του κόσμου με τα αντίστοιχα θέματα και προβλήματα? Υπάρχει το ενδιαφέρον?
Υπάρχει το ενδιαφέρον για όλους εμάς που ξέρουμε τα Ποσειδόνια πάρα πάρα πολύ καλά, τα γνωρίζουμε, ερχόμαστε χρόνια, ξέρουμε ένα στοιχείο των Ποσειδονίων είναι όχι μόνο το exhibition το οποίο γίνεται, αλλά επίσης είναι όλα τα events και τα parties τα οποία γίνονται. Γίνονται δεκάδες events καθημερινά και πάρα πολλά από αυτά τραβάνε μέχρι πάρα πολύ αργά. Θυμάμαι πριν από πάρα πολλά χρόνια, χωρίς να πω κάποιο όνομα, ήταν κάποιος Άγγλος, είπε δεν πρέπει να γίνεται κανένα event στις 9 η ώρα το πρωί, εν ώρα Ποσειδονίων. Βλέπεις, είναι λίγο περασμένα από τις 9 τώρα αυτή τη στιγμή, αλλά πίσω μου βλέπεις μια γεμάτη αίθουσα από ανθρώπους από κάθε γωνία της γης και έχουν έρθει διότι θέλουν να συμμετάσχουν, να μάθουν, να προβληθούν, να ανοίξουν τις σκέψεις τους, διότι ένα από τα πράγματα που εκφράζει τη Mare Forum είναι ο διάλογος, οι ερωτήσεις και η ανταλλαγή απόψεων. Η δικιά μου εικόνα είναι ότι τα Ποσειδόνια είναι η μεγαλύτερη ναυτιλιακή γιορτή. Είναι ένα ευτυχές γεγονός ότι συμβαίνει αυτό το event εδώ πέρα στην χώρα μας, το οποίο προβάλλει τη χώρα μας με τα πιο εξαιρετικά δεδομένα στο εξωτερικό. Πρέπει να χαρούμε και να ευχαριστούμε τον κύριο Θεμιστοκλή Βόκο, ο οποίος είχε την έμπνευση πριν από πάνω από 50 χρόνια να σκεφτεί να δημιουργήσει αυτή τη γιορτή. Αυτή η γιορτή ξεκίνησε από κάτι πάρα πολύ μικρό και έχει φτάσει να γίνει κάτι γιγαντιαίο, όπου πιστεύω άμα πάρεις και αθροίσεις όλους τους ανθρώπους οι οποίοι έρχονται, συμμετάσχουν, δουλεύουν, έρχονται από το εξωτερικό, αριθμεί άνω των 100.000 ανθρώπων. Και όχι μόνο το τι καλό κάνει για την ελληνική οικονομία, διότι γεμίζει όλα τα εστιατόρια, τα ξενοδοχεία, τα σπίτια, τα ταξί, τα ενοικιαζόμενα, τα αεροδρόμια και ούτω καθεξής. Το μόνο που κάνει για αυτή τη χώρα είναι καλό σε μια ιδιαίτερη στιγμή που η Ελλάδα μας περνάει μια δυνατή κρίση. Η ναυτιλία επίσης αρρωσταίνει, αλλά ποτέ δεν πεθαίνει. Το μέγεθος της σπουδαιότητας της ναυτιλίας στον κόσμο μας, που δυστυχώς ίσως πάρα πολλοί δεν το γνωρίζουν.
I will like to thank our sponsors also in my turn, and I will no longer keep the microphone in the airwaves. I'll pass it on to Mr. George Grassos, who I'm looking forward to seeing what he has to say, because in every event I learn a lot from this gentleman. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
think that it's obvious we must protect our planet. It's imperative because we have nowhere else to go. They're searching some 20, 30 million years, light years away, but I don't think we'll ever make it. So we have to take care of this planet as long as we're here. I'm afraid that even though we seem to have thought that it was important in 1922, it's now 2016, and we haven't really done too much to improve it, which doesn't say too much about our wish or ability to do something. So it's very many years lost, which some people say global warming has increased, others are skeptical about it. But we don't seem to have gotten it right yet. I think that what is important is critical thinking, and I think that since we haven't got it right yet, this quote by Ivar Giebel, who's a Nobel laureate of physics in 1993, is rather apt. If the theory doesn't agree with the experiment, you cut out the theory. The experiment is our atmosphere, what's happening to it, if it's worse or better or whatever, and the theories that we have made the various legislations that we have, and I'm not sure whether they're working in the right direction. For the moment, those are the regulations we have, and so we must abide by them. But the question remains, do they work? I'll go through another quote again, which I like very much. It's from Einstein. It says, "If any intelligent fool can make things bigger, more complex, and more violent, it takes a touch of genius and a lot of courage to move it in the opposite direction." That is a fairly obvious statement, because bureaucracy thrives on making things more complicated, adding a few paragraphs here and a few tweaks there, and eventually the whole thing is, it just doesn't work. For example, even though we're saying all these kind of things, for example, the oil industry, where the prices collapsed in January, February, I don't remember exactly what, said that it will balance because we expect 1.2 or 1.5 million barrels a day more consumption throughout 2016. Now, that consumption means more greenhouse gases, and just a rough approximation, that would be about 250 million metric tons of CO2 in 1 year. And that we happily accept. We don't seem to think very much about it, even though it's said, and it's the way the oil industry is going to balance itself by this greater demand. There is something helpful, at least we have COP21. But we must realize that the greenhouse gases are the result of human endeavors to improve our standard of living. That is what we're supposed to be doing, and this is how we got where we are in this world. Trade and shipping have for millennia been an important facilitator to this endeavor. And another fact is that all human endeavors are measured by their overall economic results, assuming effective pricing, and, of course, internalizing external costs is the key element of any correct legislation, because people work on the basis of stimuli. And up until now, even though we were worried about our atmosphere since 1992, we always considered that the atmosphere was a free dump. We never put a price on carbon. I think this must change. Now, in order to change properly,
We must understand human reaction to stimuli. Unfortunately, up until now, we don't seem to. So, what has shipping done over the years? Well, according to the 2009 IMO estimate of seaborne CO2 emissions, it was considered to be 2.7% of world emissions. The 2009 IMO numbers were based on 2007 measurements. Okay, 2007 was a boom year for shipping. The 2012 are 2.2%. Well, 2002 was not a very good mark. But in any case, there is a substantial drop in the CO2 emissions from shipping, even though it is not included in COP 21 and various other things. So it means that something is working correctly with shipping. The results are obviously too fast for any EEDI or any other thing that the creation of the human brain would help. So it was due to some other things. Why? Well, because fuel prices were high and ships went at a slower speed. That's what happened. And when ships go at a slower speed, they emit less, substantially less, because consumption is to the cube of the speed in shipping. So the variable expenses are completely different than the linear expenses. And so you optimize your revenue by reducing speed to where you optimize, because at some point you optimize for a certain freight rate to bunker price. That is nice to understand, but bureaucrats don't like it. Now, you can see over here the price of crude over the years. The red line is the net present value price, and the blue line is the actual price. The net present value price allows you, obviously, to compare over a period of time. It's not very accurate, but it's better than not, using nominal numbers. So you will see that between 1979 and 1980, you had a peak that was much, much higher than the peak we have now, in real terms. So any one of us that is a little bit old, and I am 73 years old and I remember that, at the time we were slow steaming, we were all calculating at what speed we should go in order to maximize our revenue, and that was a fact of life. And we did the necessary actions. Now, this shows you what I told you before, in a graphical term, that how the speed varies of the average bulk carrier, which for this the total fleet divided by the total number of ships gives you a Panamax of 73,500 tons or something like that. You have this little graph that shows you on the y-axis the speed, the most profitable speed, and on the x-axis is the ratio of the BDI to the bunker price. You would see that the correlation is 0.915, which is pretty good. So you can consider it as quite accurate. The graph was made with a lot of simulations that I have done over the years on value strips. So you see that whenever the ratio of BDI over to BP is small, the speeds become smaller. Now that can happen either because of high bunker prices or because of low BDI levels. In any case, whenever you have a low bunker price, ships speed up and therefore burn substantially more. It's normal physics. It's something that anyone could think about. We have people saying that the EEDI would save our problems, etc., etc. But all these things were written in naval architectural books quite far back. Finer drop coefficient was always known to be more, let's say, required less propulsion forces. A bigger propeller always was known, bigger, slower turning propeller was always known to be more energy efficient. It was written in books since the 80s. It was in notes before then. But the fact of the matter remains that there were Echo ships built by Burmeister and Wayne in 1981. The Mark III Panamaxes were about 25%, they burned about 25% less than the other Panamaxes being built at the time, simply because they had finer lines and a very, very big propeller with slow turning engines. And that was before anything like EEDI. But you will see that this first spike was the incentive. So cost is the incentive, not regulation, in my opinion. And it's fairly obvious that from the example that the finer the ship, the faster it will go with one man power, and the fatter it is, the slower it will go.
Now, with regard to shipping, this is again from the dry bulk. You get energy efficiency and cost efficiency, of course, when the size of the ship increases. So you had between the years 1981 and 2012 a 40% rise in the energy efficiency in the measurement of tons of fuel per ton of cargo transported, of the order of 40% simply by size alone, nothing to do with the technological inputs, improvements, etc. So shipping over the 40 years has improved its energy efficiency by 40% simply by increasing size of ships, and it has further increased with the, all the other energy efficiencies done. This is of course something that all other industries don't seem to do in quite that fashion. Now, I think the most interesting paper that I have read is this one was made by IMF in January 2016. And it says roughly what I have been saying for a long time. It mentions that the only meaningful initiative to any businessman is overall cost. It also says fiscal policies are environmentally effective. Pricing carbon increases the price of fossil fuels, electricity, etc., which promotes with one instrument and strikes the effective balance across the entire range of mitigation opportunities. Now, they also say that this year ETS, which some countries love, require accompanying price stability provisions and require auctioning allowances, not giving them away for free, which some countries do. It also says that regulations are less effective as they focus on a narrower range of mitigation opportunities. So we have had bureaucrats making all kinds of regulations and avoiding to look at the incentives that price mechanisms do create. And it's very nice of the IMF to have come out with this kind of statement. Maybe it will change thinking. Now, with regard to what the IMF says about the ETS, you have the EU ETS prices from 2005 to 2015. The left-hand chart is the IMF chart, and the right-hand chart is from theaustralian.com. I don't know why the IMF chart went the way it did in 2007, but they must have good numbers to support it. The other chart looks a little bit more effective, but the sheer fluctuations of the ETS price of carbon is no incentive for any businessman. It's great incentive for anyone, for casino economics. It's really wonderful for the financial market. They'll make loads of money on it, but I don't think it'll help the environment. I think also that we must try to eradicate from our minds glorious misconceptions. As I said before, 2.2 of the CO2 emissions come from shipping, but only 2.1% of greenhouse gases. Okay, that is again from the IMO study. But we all love nature and pastures, etc., and we call that green. But why don't we try to realize that they, according to the FAO, account for 18% of greenhouse gas emissions? Okay, that's roughly nine times more than what shipping does. And shipping transports all of the world's, 90% of the world's trade, whereas agriculture does, in fact, produce 100% of the world's food in conjunction with industry. But it's also interesting to note that from The New Scientist, the greenhouse gas emissions of 1 kilo of beef, and this is for all the beef lovers, the emissions that it produces are roughly equivalent to a drive for 250 kilometers with an average European car. So every time you eat a kilo of beef, try to think what you have done to the environment. I don't think people like this, but anyhow. So we must understand also what the effect of globalization is on trade, which we don't seem to understand. Globalization is effective when it occurs when there is tremendous price differential between countries, and so you set up a factory elsewhere, and the whole idea of shipping technology across and shipping the finished product back makes more economic sense. Now, as emerging economies grow their GDP faster than the industrial economies, that gap seems to become less. And it has been observed for the container trades that the container traffic was increasing at about 2-point-something times the GDP growth in the pre-2008 period, and right now it's increasing at a fraction, let's say 0.8%, or that's the kind of number that I've heard for the container thing. On the other hand, the dry bulk trade similarly was increasing actually it had the growth rate until 2002 of minus 0.5 times X, the GDP growth. And it was on a decreasing trend due to efficiencies. And then China came in 2002 and started, increasing tremendously dry bulk import demand, and it soared. And in 2014, as you can see, it reversed downwards. So it's not a business as usual scenario in either in shipping, either in containers or in dry bulk, and so you can't extrapolate what it's going to be like based on past performance. It's you must really look at how the world economy works and how shipping works within this international economy. So I think that with these kind of thoughts, I will thank you very much, and maybe say a few words about some things that I don't like about the regulation. For example, it's based, the regulation started and were based on some flawed comments. In IMO's greenhouse gas study of 2009, paragraph 5.25 on page 47 says, the pertinent words, the technical operator may tend to minimize time in dry dock to minimize off-hire cost and other maintenance costs, e.g. painting costs, while at the same time handing the fuel bill to the commercial operator. This is total unadulterated nonsense. But it is written in an IMO document, and it helped. It was used by a lot of people trying to figure out what they wanted to do with shipping. It influenced their decision making, and that is very, very bad. The fact of the matter is that no commercial operator will accept practices leading to inflated fuel bills above the ship's speed and consumption warranties, which are legally binding. So if we burn more than what we advertise our ship to burn, we pay for it to the charter. So we have every interest on keeping our ships clean, despite what IMO says. The experts at IMO say, they're not saying it anymore. One other thing that is quite interesting and quite eye-opening is the fact that, they like making studies. And so they made studies of what was activity studies, etc. And those were the results. And one of these curves was the IEA projection, which the projections from the activities were about 50% more fuel was burned than what the IEA was. And, you want to ask the question, where on earth did that amount of fuel come from? Where do 50% more rogue oil wells and more rogue refineries exist that sell these things? Because all refineries are regulated by the taxman, and they have tax people inside taxing the whatever thing it is that they're putting out, whether it's lubricants, shipping, bunkers, or gasoline. So if we make such studies, we're really wasting our time. We're not looking at the real picture. We have to, in order to consider the other curves credible, someone must explain the divergence. They never seem to. And also, we seem to have all kinds of regulations, particularly with regard to sulfur oxides and nitrogen oxides, which I don't believe are correct, because the scientists don't believe that they are correct. I'm not an environmental scientist. According to a paper done by a group of five or six mostly European scientists, according to the regulation as it was before, ship emissions had a cooling effect on the atmosphere for 350 years. With the regulations as they're promulgated now, that cooling is down to 70 years. And that is because sulfur oxides actually shield the sun rays by creating clouds, and so they cool the atmosphere. And nitrogen oxide destroys methane lifetime, and methane is a greenhouse gas about 23, some say even 30 times more potent than CO2. So are we really sure of our science, or are we just sorcerers or apprentices playing around with various concepts? I think I want to say thank you here. Well, I don't know, it's not going anywhere. It's going the other way. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Gratzos. I remember you 20 years ago when you delivered the speech in Rotterdam, the first Mare Forum. it's exactly 20 years ago, and every time we learn a lot of your speeches and ideas and thoughts. Thank you very much. I think we will have a discussion later in the first session. Now I give the floor to Mr. Tsavlidis, who is the chairman of the conference, and he will chair also the first session. Thank you.
Especially for my delay in getting here with 2.5 hours traffic. That's part of Greek chaos, but I apologize profusely. Before making my presentation, I just want to say a couple of words which I think are very important. First of all, besides thanking my beloved friend John Kostoulis for inviting me to chair the session, and we always find that the Mighty Forum conferences make us all think out of the box, and we actually, I think, do contribute to finding solutions, even though we don't actually come to them sometimes. Secondly, I think, which is very important, is that the Posidonia, as you know, has been going on for many, many years now, and the whole idea was perceived by Themis Vokos. Themis Vokos is a beloved friend. We've known him for, I think, probably coming up for half a century. Basically, he was he's a man of outstanding vision, and I just want to mention two words in public and on record here to thank him sincerely for literally putting the Posidonia on the map. For you, those of you who weren't present, he was honored a few days ago at the Propeller Club for his outstanding contribution towards shipping, and I would also like to put on record that I think it should be the Greek government and Greece at large which should say thank you to Themis Vokos. And that's what I want to start with. Thank you. Now, one other point I'd like to mention is the recession which we're going through. This is probably going off the track, but that's part of my character, I suppose. But you have to bear with me if you can. We're all in a recession. A deep recession in Greece, which of course part of what we're going through now is part of the recession. But I heard a few words a few days ago which I think are very, very, very important, and I'd like you all to leave today having these things in mind, especially the younger generation. It's the following. Recessions do not die from old age. Recessions don't go into a pension mode. So effectively, on one positive note, I'd like to mention that whatever situation we're going through worldwide, and particularly in our country here, especially for the younger generation, keep your head high, have your stamina and enthusiasm to go ahead, and don't worry, because at the end of the day, things will work out. On that note, I might as well start my presentation on the environment. Now, this is one of a few pictures of our beloved Greece. You probably all recognize parts of those little scenes. One's in the west, is one of the southwest part of Milos. Then you've got Mykonos, we've got another part of Chalkidiki, we've got the beautiful islands of the Santorini on the bottom left. And basically, this scenery is what a lot of you come here for on your holidays. For the beauty which we find in Greece, which I find, even probably which I'm somewhat subjective about, is perhaps one of the most beautiful places in the world. Now, having said that, our beloved poet, Odysseus Elitis, which in fact for yours who don't know was a Nobel Prize winner, Θεέ μου, τι μπλε ξοδεύεις για να μη σε βλέπουμε. Oh God, you spend so much blue so that we cannot see you. This is part of the sea, which is basically transformed Greece into a maritime nation, which starting for 5,000 years of history, go on to our beauty, and then filling up by all of us actually earning a living from the sea. So I said, without wanting to sound too poetic, I think I had to start by at least quoting our Nobel Prize winner. Now, what if? Well, you saw the earlier pictures of the beautiful scenery, and I'm quite sure we have seas all over the world which basically we have to protect and keep out of any issues which may arise, but these situations like you see now has happened, And it can happen here, it can happen in the Mediterranean, it can happen everywhere. And that's one of the issues which I think that all of us, especially those of us who are involved in shipping and in educational standards, to literally eliminate the probability of these tragedies happening, is that that's one of our things which we have to put in perspective. Now, unfortunately, it goes back a long, long way. It's part of what the issues of capital in the production of what we need in terms of requires a supply and demand need. And unfortunately, this is indirectly the consequence of our inability, in history at least, to literally cope with reality. As you know, all of you who've been going back in history and been around for a while, we started from the Torrey Canyon, we had the Exxon Valdez, we had the Erika, Deep Sea Horizon, and effectively now we've come to a point where at least I think one of the landmark issues which took place last year during the Paris Agreement was, I think, I'd like to believe that we have come to a point where what is happening in history will not happen in the future. Now, the Paris Agreement was, as you know, was drawn up, was an agreement which had all nations participant for about 10-12 days in December last year. They came up with their statement of good intention, setting forth all the aspirational goals to limit global temperature and actually eliminate the idea of bringing down the one and a half degrees centigrade temperature of the CO2 levels in a certain frame of time. Now, the frame of time, unfortunately, I think perhaps it's unrealistic, very optimistic, mind you, and I'm not quite sure whether, even though I heard, and I've actually, by the way, I've actually heard George Grassos in other presentations, and I think he is somebody who's more than conversant than anybody, at least I know, on these issues, and I think you'll find that he has some, as you mentioned earlier, some surprises and some aspects which are perhaps contradictory in terms of what we hear and what we read in public. Now, the Paris Agreement had the intention of curbing the greenhouse gas emissions and basically and towards the strongest targets, which in fact what I'm concerned about is I'm not quite aware of the fact, or I actually have in mind, I'm not quite sure whether it will be able to be achieved realistically. Now, shipping, unfortunately, was not mentioned, was rather the IMO, which was supposed to be the body which actually covers the shipping aspects, was actually put forward in a document during the first proceedings, and then for some mysterious reason they withdraw the document, so effectively the IMO was not mentioned, or at least in the final Paris Agreement. Now, that was taken by the shipping industry in the first instance as being good news, but unfortunately, as you probably find what's happening now, it's bad news because it's leaving the IMO, which is the main body which should be controlling and using all the regulations for shipping, we may find ourselves being subjected to the European Union intervention, which as far as they're concerned, it could very well be that the IMO has not been doing enough. And that is something which we'll have to worry about. Their argument, of course, is that they see these reports which have been issued last year. Last year, in fact, was one of the hottest years on record, and perhaps coming with that kind of information is something which may exacerbate their temper and their appetite to actually be involved in an area which they shouldn't be involved with. Now, they more or less come to the idea of actually being intrusive towards the IMO, which I say I think is totally wrong, because at the end of the day, the IMO is the main body which should be the authority to control and to administer everything related to the shipping aspects in terms of emissions and also other safety regulations. Now, the International Chamber of Shipping came in, perhaps as I can call them salvors, if I may, to try to save the situation, to say, well, the IMO will actually pull their socks up, they will actually comply, and they will do what they have to do without any kind of intervention from the European Union. Now, I'd like to mention also clearly the authority of the IMO should not be challenged. Now, after the Paris Agreement, unfortunately, we are hearing some of the wrong noises coming from the European Union, and I'd like to put the question here, which perhaps we can cover after in our debate. do they actually intend implementing any unilateral decisions to cut shipping emissions? I hope they don't, but on the other hand, it's questionable because of all the vibes we're hearing in the press. Now, here, chaos will exist if they get involved, because by having unilateral decisions coming from the European Union and without having the IMO as being the predominant body to literally cover all aspects, we're going to have chaos. Now, the reason why I put our beloved friend Tsipras behind chaos, because Tsipras, unfortunately, as you've probably seen today, is contributing towards the chaos which we have in Greece. So I thought, since we are in Greece, I think it would be perhaps more commensurate with the fact that I have to mention him as being the culprit who's causing or has contributed to all the problems we're facing today. Thank you. Now, the last and not least, I'm going to be short, is the union is a strength, synergia, synergy, a Greek word. Now, to address prevention and pollution and protect the environment, it's a perception which we all have to work together. We don't have one-upmanship, we don't have any sense of competition, and we all here in a common body, and that's one word, unfortunately, even though it's Greek, Greeks have perhaps failed in the past to apply this regulation or this aspect perception, which I think will be a tremendous benefit if we get down to our sources and realize that if we comply with this, we have a much better future and a much we have cleaner seas in future, and we'll have a much better way of actually protecting our environment. Now, our politicians, well, here we are, colorful characters. Politicians are politicians. I sometimes question whether they really care. I take the view they do not, because at the end of the day, if you really come to the nitty-gritty, we have to compare between oil and gas as our source of energy. Now, the bottom line is, gas has always been the energy source which literally is less polluting and will actually have caused less consequence to our environment. Unfortunately, we're still sticking to the oil, and the oil reason why we're sticking to the oil is because the oil price and all the other political agendas involved will literally not allow that balance to occur and have the utopia come to surface, which basically means that in future, gas is the real energy source which we should be using. And as I mentioned before, we have the politicians, and at the end of the day, it's all about money. Unfortunately, it's all about money. Sometimes we have to also think, and I'd like to address you who are present in this room today and spend time here, is that we all have a commercial activity, we all have to earn a living, pay the bills, but at the end of the day, we also have to maintain a fundamental code of ethics. Now, maintaining code of ethics means that we don't always in life, we shouldn't always put money as a number one priority. Having said that, our friend Einstein mentioned that we cannot solve the problems by using the same kind of thinking that we used when we created them. Now, that's food for thought, ladies and gentlemen. I'd like to complete here and finish my presentation, and I thank you for your time, and again, my apologies for my delay. Thank you.
George, thank you very much. You will take it over, of course, but as we have to go quick, I ask Ms. Christine Berg, who is head of the unit Commission for Safety and Ship Source Pollution from the European Commission. Thank you very much, Ms. Berg, that you accepted our invitation to come here today.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, as one of those bureaucrats from Brussels, from the European Commission, I welcome the opportunity to meet with such a distinguished audience representing the maritime community from around the world. And I hope I can address some of the wrong noises that have been referred to earlier. As you know, the European Commission is fully committed to promoting highest safety standards, but also preventing environmental pollution from ships. And I think I have to remember, all of us have to remember, that we had learned our lessons in past decades in Europe. Regarding environmental pollution from ships, I would like to share with you what the Commission, together with our member states, are doing to limit negative environmental impacts of shipping, but by taking care of the realities of shipping, which we are not totally unknown with. Before giving you some concrete examples of our initiatives in this field, I would like to address one of the questions that were raised by the organizers of this session, namely, what went wrong with the Paris Agreement? Now, I dare to reply, nothing or nothing went wrong yet, at least from the shipping perspective. In our view, also the international transport sector is not specifically mentioned in the agreement, as we know. Keeping global warming well below 2% as the long-term goal would not be possible without the contribution of global sectors like aviation and shipping. Therefore, ICAO and IMO, and we are committed to IMO, should consider the adoption of the Paris Climate Agreement, the diplomatic masterpiece of Laurent Fabius, as an important signal of the readiness at international level to take measures and address firmly climate change. And at least at IMO level, this momentum, we think, has already shown its impact. During the latest meeting of the MEPC in April, there was overwhelming support for a mandatory global data collection scheme concerning ship fuel consumption data. And the majority of delegations, including previously reticent parties such as China and Brazil, supported this. On this basis, we think there is now green light for the formal adoption of the amendment of MARPOL at the October session of MEPC. Also, there is indication that discussions on a process, a roadmap towards setting a fair contribution of the international shipping sector for the Paris COP21 agreement will pick up again based on what ICS has submitted in October. And we look forward to hearing more views from industry players. The fact that the shipping industry starts to voice its support for ambitious environmental measures is to us a sign that the sector is not planning to be left behind. The race, also Mr. Gratzos would say a very slow race for green solutions, to answer one of the questions put by the organizers. We at the EU are committed to play our part in setting the tone at the international level. And I would like now to just highlight a few of the priorities. On the CO2 emissions from fuel consumption for ship, you know that in the European Union, the implementation of the so-called MRV regulation, taking care of monitoring, reporting and verification of fuel consumption data, is taking shape this year, and it will effectively start applying to ships calling to EU ports on the 1st of January 2018. The EU scheme was meant to serve as a useful example for the development of a global scheme, and there is little doubt about it. It provided additional impetus to the discussions in the IMO and convinced many states to agree to a mandatory global scheme. As the Commission has said in many occasions, given the international nature of shipping, our preferred and most effective method of reducing greenhouse gases in international maritime transport would be a global instrument. In fact, the European MRV regulation contains a review clause for the event that an agreement on global data collection system has been reached. So we are under an obligation to assess the global scheme in view of a possible alignment. And we will do that as soon as we know the details of the global scheme including a set of IMO guidelines, which will give us important elements such as monitoring methods and verification rules. Clearly, a robust and enforceable system agreed in the IMO will make it much easier for us to convince the co-legislators in the European Union, the Council, meaning our member states, and the European Parliament, that the alignment is the best thing for the EU to do. Hence, achieving a robust data collection scheme is a priority for the upcoming discussions. We count on industry support for the adoption of such a scheme to allow a meaningful monitoring and compliance at global level. It may also be beneficial for the IMO to compare data from the future database with estimates run under accepted models, such for instance those that have been used for the third greenhouse gas study, in order to assess the quality of the global data reporting and improve also the quality of the forecasting models, which will play no doubt a role in the future. A word on the EEDI. There is a review now ongoing on the reduction rates for 2020 to 2025 on the EEDI for new ships. I think there are some cases where we see overperformance and therefore a bit of adjustment may be adequate. It's important that we do this adjustment in order to build on achievements and provide further incentives for technological developments, resulting in greenhouse gas reductions and therefore also closing the gap that may need to be filled by a market-based measure. A word on SOx and NOx, another key area for air pollution from ships, where we have very good feedback from the implementation of the European Sulfur Directive, which aims at reducing the level of SOx emissions. We see a very high level of compliance, and importantly, an associated SO2 concentration reduction in the range of 50 to 80%. In the EU SECA, which is quite a good performance. In this context, the upcoming MEPC meeting is critical for us to confirm 2020 as the applicable date for a global sulfur cap, which we believe is feasible and enforceable, in particular when looking at current crude prices. In relation to NOx, you will see that the Baltic states and the North Sea countries will make a submission to MEPC 70. We fully support this. We support this because NOx emissions from shipping are a major source of airborne deposit of nitrogen, aggravating the serious, really serious eutrophication of the Baltic Sea. The initiative, which will be on the table of MEPC in October, goes back to 2007. And it's good to see that in addition to the Baltic Sea, now the countries bordering the North Sea have agreed to submit in parallel an NECA designation request for consideration at MEPC. The two NECAs are proposed to take effect as of 1st of January 2021, and they will concern new ships. And we are hopeful that these proposals will become a reality, so that both sides of the Atlantic will start to enforce MARPOL Annex 6 Tier 3 standards for NOx as of 2021. In the interest of being short, I won't refer to issues regarding ship recycling or MARPOL Annex 5, but I think with what we have discussed so far, you can hear that we are committed to progress in the IMO. We think, most importantly, at this juncture, we have to work together in the IMO to set and implement a meaningful contribution to the international efforts to combat climate change. We think that the industry engagement in this is fundamental so that we can strike a fair burden share, which is in accordance with the realities of shipping, which is not really prone to an ETS, and without hampering the sector's development and competitiveness. We trust with the right input and goodwill from all parties, this actually can be achieved at IMO, so that the parties and dinners we see hosted in the margins of Posidonia will not become veggie parties only. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.